Greetings, dear aspirants. Welcome to today's current affairs session of Civilspedia. Today, we'll be discussing about National Health Authority, about Climate Change Performance Index, and about Project Green Agriculture and Financial Stability Report under our prelims topic, and about the recent second half-yearly financial stability report, and about Astana Declaration under our mains topic. So let's move on to our first prelims topic of the day, National Health Authority. So the keywords that you need to know about is what is the National Health Authority and what is the ministry which will implement this particular authority will be a part of, and about the governing board of this particular authority. So we have something called the National Health Agency now. So this will be replaced by the National Health Authority. So this will take care of the proper implementation of the this particular government's flagship program, Ayushman Bharat or Jan Arogya Yojana. So this particular National Health Agency has been restructured as the National Health Authority for better implementation of PM Jan Arogya Yojana. So this will give in more accountability, authority and mandate to the National Health Authority in order to implement this particular scheme. So this particular scheme, this particular National Health Authority will be an attached office to the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So please keep this in mind. And something about the governing board. So in the present National Health Agency, we have an existing multi-tier decision-making structure. So this will be replaced with the governing board. So what is the prominence in the governing board is it will have members from the state government. So they'll be placed on a rotational basis. So that will be a say for the states as well. And it also contain members from the government and the domain experts, this particular governing board. So this is all you need to know about the National Health Authority from prelims point of view. So let's move on to our next topic, the Climate Change Performance Index. When you're studying about index, try to know which organization released that particular index and what is India's rank. And with respect to this topic, you need to know what are the key performing indices in which India has scored well. So the Climate Change Performance Index for the year 2019 has been released on 1st of January. 2019. So they have told that Sweden is the best performing country in this particular climate change performing index, and Morocco from African nation has been ranked second. So India's rank here for the year 2019, this is the 11th rank. So out of 56 countries plus the European Union, India scored 11th rank, which is a good rank. And there's also an improvement in the ranking compared to the previous year 2018, where India was placed 14th. So regarding this particular index, this index is published on an annual basis. So every year they publish this index, and it is published by together by the German Watch, the New Climate Institute and the Climate Action Network. So please keep this in mind. So it is not some specialized agency of UN or some multilateral body which is releasing, but institutes in collaboration are releasing this particular index. And if you see, the key performing indices where India scored better are the greenhouse gas emissions, renewable energy, energy use per capita, national and international climate policy assessments. So these four are the methodology based on which the countries are ranked for the climate change performance. So they have taken into account Paris Agreement promises, which the countries have voluntarily taken up, each countries. So they go for either subjective or objective evaluation of data. So India scored better in the greenhouse gas emissions and with respect to energy use. So with respect to renewable energy as a part of total energy basket, India is on the way to meet its goals. So this is all you need to know about the Climate Change Performance Index with prelims point of view. So next project is the Project Green Agriculture. In this particular project, you need to know the project is implemented by whom and the project is funded by whom. And with respect to this topic, you need to know the five landscapes under the project. So the government has come up with a project called Project Green Agriculture. So the title is Transforming India's Agriculture for Global Environment Benefits, Agriculture plus Environment. Agriculture plus environment. and conservation of critical biodiversity and forest landscapes. If you see in the recent scenario, a lot of forests are being destroyed to convert into agricultural lands in order to meet the country's food requirements. But we can also go for sustainable agriculture. So India's got something called National Mission for Sustainable Agriculture. And this project is largely oriented towards India's national mission towards sustainable agriculture. So this is a $33.5 million project, which is funded by the Global Environment Facility. And in India, it will be implemented by in combination or in collaboration with two ministries, the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare and the Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change, because it involves two components, agriculture and environment, and in joined together in collaboration with the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, or the FAO. So they have shortlisted 5 landscapes where they will target to work towards a sustainable agriculture. So the first one is the Chambal landscape in the state of Madhya Pradesh. So Chambal is a ravine landscape, and Dampa landscape in Mizoram, a mountainous landscape. Then Simlipal landscape in the state of Odisha, which is a forest landscape, and Desert National Park landscape in the state of Rajasthan. So it is a desert landscape, and Corbett Rajaji landscape in Uttarakhand, which is again a forest landscape. So these 5 landscapes, please remember it from prelims point of view, and who implements the project and who funds the project. So this is all you need to know about Project Green Agriculture, because in the recent years, you can see a lot of questions pertaining to environment and recent methodologies or innovations or inventions in agriculture. So this is more relevant to the current year as well. And the next topic of the day is the financial stability report. So here I'll be covering the prelims perspective of this particular report and also the mains perspective. So let's move on to the prelims perspective first. So when you're studying about financial stability report, just try to know who has released the report and at what frequency is this particular report being released, and something about the financial stability and the development council in India. So the recent news in Indu was that there are signs of turnaround on RBI's financial stability report, because gross non-performing assets ratio has quite decreased in the public sector banks. So let's see the prelims perspective as of now. So the first fact is the financial stability report is being released by the Reserve Bank of India, and the frequency is once in 6 months. So they release the report at the end of June, third or fourth week of June, and on a third and fourth week of December every year. So this December 2018 report has been released in the, towards the end of the December month recently, and it would reflect the collective assessment of the subcommittee of the Financial Stability and Development Council. You should know that the finance minister heads the Financial Stability and the Development Council, but there is again a subcommittee under this Financial Development and Stability, Financial Stability and Development Council. This particular subcommittee will be headed by the governor of RBI. Hence, the report is being released by RBI. So you are more likely to get confused that released by RBI and the head for the subcommittee would be the finance minister. It is not the case. Both are the head of RBI. Hence, this particular report is being released by RBI. So please keep this in mind. And with regards to Financial Stability and Development Council, it will work towards financial sector development and stability, and it will also focus on the substantive issues relating to the inter-regulatory coordination, a coordination between the different financial markets, banks to banks, banks to mutual funds, or banks to asset management companies, etc. So let's move on to the mains perspective about what are the contents that are present in the financial stability report. So this particular financial stability report would discuss the overall assessment of the systemic risks of the financial market, and about the global and domestic macro financial risks, and about the health of the financial institutions, about its performance and risk. So this particular topic was introduced in the year December 2014, post this NPA problem, the non-performing assets issue. So these are the three overall contents of the report. So let's discuss these three contents in detail, because the next report is due to be released by the June of 2000. 19, which is before our prelims exam. So this particular report is of more significance. Let's see. So when it comes to overall assessment of the financial markets, the RBI has told that the India's financial system would remain stable. And the banking sector has shown signs of improvement because the gross non-performing assets ratio has increased, which we'll be seeing in a later slide. But they've also told that the global economic environment and the emerging trends in the financial sector pose some challenges to the improving banking sector in India. So the second overall topic is the global and the domestic macro financial risks. So to the global market and the domestic market. So they have told that the global growth outlook for 2018 and 19 remains steady because as of now, there is no financial slowdown and the global markets are performing relatively good. But there is a spillover risk to the emerging economies because the advanced economies are tightening their monetary policy on their side. So all the investors are going to invest the money in the advanced markets and they're not going to come into the emerging economies like India. So the emerging economies are likely to take a hit because of the credit flow. So tightening of financial conditions in advanced economies and protectionist trade policies. If you see the recent US-China trade war and also because of the recent Iran sanctions by the US and global geopolitical tension, which I told the US-Iran sanctions. And next thing is the GDP has showed slight moderation in the quarter two of 2018-19. So if the release is if the report is released in the month of December, it would assess all those data from March to September for the December report. For the June report, from October to Feb. So two quarters would be checked here. So they have checked the quarter two for 2018-19 as a part of December report, and they have told that the GDP has showed light moderation, which means it is less when compared to the previous quarter when checked. And the inflation remains contained. So the inflation is within the target for that particular quarter. But as of now, the inflation has increased. So don't confuse both terms. And next thing is the capital flows to the emerging markets, which will be affected by the gradual monetary policy normalization in advanced economies and uncertainty in the global trade regime, especially because of the recent US-China trade war. The trade is likely to take a hit. So this has been highlighted by the RBI in its financial stability report. And it has called for a greater vigilance in domestic financial markets because there are some structural shifts in the credit intermediation. So before the situation or the scenario was like, banks used to trade amongst themselves. It used to be interbank. But now banks are more very much relying on the asset management companies or the mutual funds to get their capital. So this is called shadow banking. So just have an idea about this and the evolving interconnectivity between banks and the non-banks, which I told, between the banks and the asset management companies or the mutual funds. So the third overall topic is regarding the health of the financial institutions, which comprises of the performance and the risks. So if you see the credit growth of the scheduled commercial banks has improved between this particular period, March 18 to September 2018, largely driven by the public sector banks. Still, PSUs are lacking in the credit growth, but it is being complemented by the public private sector banks, which are performing relatively well when compared to the public sector banks. So next is the capital adequacy ratio, or also called the capital to risk weighted assets ratio. So this we discussed in one of our previous classes with regards to the Basel Convention on the banking regulations, where the Basel Convention has stipulated that each country has to maintain at least 8% of its total assets as the capital adequacy ratio. In India, RBI has mandated 9% for all the banks and especially 12% for the private public sector banks. So if you see right now, overall, the capital adequacy ratio has declined, but well about the Basel Convention mark. And but if you see for PSUs, where the RBI has mandated 12%, it has reduced from 11.7 to 11.3%, which is a cause of concern for the RBI or the India's banking regulator. So where we have performed well is the improvement of the gross non-performing assets ratio. and just know about the prompt corrective action framework with respect to this gross non-performing assets. So in March 2018, it was 11.5, but it has reduced to 10.8 in September of 2018. And in the next two quarters, it will even further reduce to 10.3%. So this is a very good improvement because the gross non-performing assets ratio of the public sector banks has also come down, but it has largely come down in the private sector banks. Hence, we can see an overall slowdown. And with regards to the analysis of the financial network structure for this particular period from September 2017 to 18, it reveals that an shrinking interbank market, which I again told the transaction has to happen between banks and banks, but in this case it's happening between banks and the other asset management companies and mutual funds for raising funds, and with the non-banking financial institutions and housing finance companies for lending. So the public sector banks are not able to properly pool their money or circulate their money. So this is all you need to know about the financial stability report, and this will be largely helpful for your mains answers. So let's move on to our next topic, mains topic of the day, Astana declaration. So this is this particular declaration is pertaining to the health sector. So all the countries of the world came up with the Astana declaration in the second global conference on primary healthcare. So you need to know about the first global conference of the primary healthcare, where all the governments of the world came up with the Alma-Ata declaration. So one thing is the Alma-Ata declaration, and second thing is the Astana declaration. So the declaration has come up like from Alma-Ata towards universal health coverage and sustainable development goals. You know that health for all, or the health comes under the sustainable development goal number 3, which tells that ensure healthy lives and promote well-being for all at all ages. So this particular Alma-Ata declaration focuses largely on the universal health coverage, or the UHC model, and the sustainable development goals. So we already have our own voluntary contributions under this particular sustainable development goal for health, where India is largely focusing on the maternal health and the baby in the infant health. So let's not deal much about the sustainable development goals, but we need to know something about this UHC and the primary health care. This is universal health coverage, which includes all your insurance component and overall well-being. And this primary health care will be a component of this universal health coverage. So now this Astana declaration focuses largely on the sustainable nature of the primary health care centers. So in pursuit of health for all, and it has sought the extensive role of the governments in the health sector. So let's try to differentiate between this Alma-Ata declaration and the Astana declaration, because in 2018 mains there was a question with regards to disaster management. So the question went like differentiate between the actions taken by India before and after implementing the Sendai framework, and some comparison between the Sendai framework and the Hyogo framework of 2005. So in those lines, you can expect a question to compare between the Astana declaration and the Alma-Ata declaration, and initiatives taken by India post the Astana declaration and before or after the Astana declaration. So this will be helpful for you in the mains. So in Alma-Ata declaration, they have declared health as the human right, or a basic fundamental right. And this gave a definition for health, a proper definition for health, where they have told that health as a state of complete physical, mental and social well-being. So health, before that health largely focused on the physical well-being only, but they have taken into this mental component and the social component of well-being, and not just merely the absence of diseases. And they came up with a declaration that health for all by 2000, that is nothing but the equitable distribution of healthcare by preventing the inequalities. So your inequalities can be social, political and economical. So three types of inequalities. By overcoming these inequalities, we can provide an equitable distribution of healthcare. And they also introduced the component called the primary healthcare. And they came up with several interrelated components of primary healthcare, such as education, nutrition, clean water, sanitation, and mother and child health, immunization, access to treatment, availability of essential medicines. And they also called for the development of the health workforce or the manpower for this particular health sector. And they also called for the use of appropriate technologies. And if you see the Astana Declaration of 2018, which came up exactly after 48 years of this Alma-Ata Declaration, they have acknowledged health as a human right or a fundamental right. And now they have called for strengthening of the primary health care, which is a cornerstone of sustainable health system of the universal health coverage. And the health-related sustainable development goals, as I already told, it is the UHC plus the SDGs. So it has called for promotive, preventive, curative, rehabilitative services and palliative care. So promotive is to promote health of any individual and go for a preventive health, curative health by giving medicines and rehabilitative services, those suffering from ailments and palliative care, which is like giving immediate care even without diagnosing what the disease is. So it must be accessible to all. And avoid poverty due to out-of-pocket expenditures. So we all know that the developing nations of the world are suffering from this out-of-pocket expenditure. So the reason why many countries came up with insurance schemes, but that was not a holistic scheme. So what are the commitments made in this particular Astana Declaration? Before that, you need to know the commitments made under the Alma-Ata Declaration, which was nothing but this equitable distribution, health workforce development, use of appropriate technologies and multi-sectoral approach. So more or less, the commitments are same in the Astana Declaration. So it has called for making bold political choices for health across sectors. So in Alma-Ata Declaration, they emphasized on removing three inequalities, social, political and economical. Here, this particular Astana Declaration has focused largely on the political part by making bold political choices, but it has not identified the need to come over this particular social inequality and economic inequality, which is a major reason for the majority of the developing countries of the world to suffer with regards to health related issues. And the second commitment was to build a sustainable primary health care, which will have these following components: knowledge and capacity building, where they call for developing of the scientific knowledge plus the traditional knowledge. If you see many of those countries which had earlier civilizations like India or China, the traditional medicinal systems are already in place, and this goes along with the recent allopathic medicine. And they have also called to increase the human resources for health and to improve the technology and come up with financing. So the financing part has to be largely taken care by the governments, and we'll be seeing some status with regards to India in our next slide. And it has also called to empower the individuals and the communities to have a proper awareness about health. Nothing but bringing an awareness to the common public about the health, so that majority of health related issues by proper way of life can be solved instead of going for advanced healthcare systems. And fourth one is to align the stakeholder support to national policies, strategies and plans. So multi-sectoral approach. So all the NGOs that are working, the private sectors that are working and the local bodies that are working towards promoting the health, they all have to come up and align themselves together towards the national health policies. And if you see the actions, it has called for acting either in solidarity, that is the government working for themselves, or to have a functioning between the governments, knowledge sharing between the governments, and along with WHO and UNICEF and all other stakeholders. And they've also called for a periodical review of the implementation of the declaration. So this particular Astana Declaration will now be taken to the United Nations General Assembly of 2019, where the political people, which is nothing but the entire polity of the world, will discuss with regards to this Astana Declaration. So you need to know India's present and future contributions towards the Astana Declaration. As I already told, it largely focused on universal health coverage, the Alma-Ata Declaration. And now Astana will be focusing largely on the primary healthcare centers. If you see this universal health coverage, it has a top to down approach when it comes to insurance. But when it comes to the primary healthcare systems, it will have a bottom to up approach. So everything can be cured at the bottom. if the primary health centers are very strong. So this will have a bottom to up approach. And you also need to know that it has to shift from the vertical programs to the holistic care. But this particular Alma-Ata declaration was not a real great success because the government started focusing on vertical programs and the famous GOIBFF, G-O-I-B-F-F-F, the components of all these PHCs which the Alma-Ata declaration came up with, they did not take up all the components of that particular declaration, but they went with some components only. Growth planning, your ORS, breastfeeding, immunization, then family planning, etc. So it largely focused on paternal and the maternal healthcare. Sorry, the maternal and the infant healthcare. But they did not know that the healthcare for the other sections of the population, like the old ages, also should be taken care. They largely focused on infant and the maternal healthcare. If you see, all our sustainable development goals are also oriented towards this infant and the maternal healthcare. So now it is time for us to shift from the vertical programs to holistic care. That is why India has come up with our flagship program, Ayushman Bharat, which will focus both this primary health centers and also the universal health coverage. Universal health coverage. So the bottom pyramid, which is nothing but the primary health centers, which has been termed as health and wellness centers, which will comprise both the primary healthcare centers and the sub-centers that are already present in India. So this will largely focus on PHCs, and the secondary and the tertiary healthcare will focus on this universal health coverage component, which is nothing but the National Health Protection Scheme or the Jan Arogya Yojana. So this is health and wellness centers, and this is Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. So this will provide an holistic healthcare to the country, to the country. So they have planned to come up with around 1.5 lakh health and wellness centers and coming up with 5 lakh insurance for the general public. So this is all about the Ayushman Bharat. So this will aim to provide the holistic care. And second thing is the quality of health care needs to be improved. So after this Alma-Ata declaration, all the governments of the world came up with this primary healthcare center, but that was too much specific. So the quality of healthcare was also not that much good. Even in India, if you see, only few states are performing good. States like Kerala, Tamil Nadu, or Maharashtra performing good. But the quality of healthcare remains substandard in many of the states. And if you also see, some barriers has to be reduced. First thing is the access to the sub-centers, where I told primary health care centers and the sub-centers are two components, but access to sub-centers are beyond that particular limit. So it has to be within the 3-kilometer limit. And availability of healthcare personnel, which is a perennial issue for the Indian government because the population is too huge to handle by the government. And next thing is the training and enhanced pay to the frontline workers. So this frontline workers includes your Anganwadi workers and also your ASHA workers. So right now, their pay is very much less, 2000 to 1500 only. This can be improved by the state governments. And training can be imparted to these frontline workers so they will have a proper connect with the local people, so that a lot of primary health care can be taken care by these particular personals only. And the Chhattisgarh government recently came up with this rural medical assistance program. So they have hired some mid-level health workers. So you have primary level health workers like the ASHA workers or the Anganwadi workers, and you have medical officers, say tertiary level. In between, you can have some middle level, where these people will play the role of the medical officers if you give them proper training and support. So such a system can be implemented across all the states. And final thing is the spending on the healthcare. If you see, as of 2015, India's overall spending towards health in its budget is 1.02%. Now, this has to improve against this target of by 2025. India has committed that it will increase its spending to 2.5%. But right now, India is just around 1.2% as of 2018. So the target is nowhere near it. We are almost lagging behind 50%. So the spending has also to increase. So this is how India can contribute to Astana declaration. But Astana declaration is more likely to be a failure because again, the corporate interests have largely been taken into account and major portions of the Astana declaration has been diluted. So this is all about the Astana declaration that you need to know from Main's perspective. So please do like, comment and share the video and please subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.